Cherubs, in the early hours of the morning of September 2nd, 1666, a flame sparked in a bakery on Pudding Street in London. By that afternoon, the fire had taken over the city, and by the time it was over, more than 13,000 houses had been destroyed, and close to a quarter of the city's population was left homeless. London had to be rebuilt, and in that rebuilding, it took a giant leap into the modern world. The Great Cathedral of St. Paul's was one of the buildings destroyed by that fire, and Christopher Wren was asked to lead its reconstruction. When he showed up at the scene of the destroyed building, he outlined his plan for the new church. He asked somebody nearby to quickly grab a stone so that he could mark out where the crossing would be. The stone given to him had been part of the old cathedral's floor and was engraved with a single word and a phoenix. It said, "Resurgam, I will rise again." It was a good start. Now, Wren was a founding member of the Royal Society, a scientific academy, and he was a mathematician and astronomer first, and then he dabbled in architecture. As such, he was acutely aware that the 17th century had seen more scientific advancement in Europe than perhaps any one century in history. Wren intended his version of St. Paul's to look forward and have the building itself participate in the construction of more scientific knowledge. Wren started work on the cathedral in 1674, and its completion was celebrated in 1711. That's 37 years, with a single architect, and that architect liked to experiment. So when he built high platforms, he used them for height experiments, like pendulums and barometric experiments. Wren wasn't alone in doing this kind of thing. His friend and collaborator Robert Hooke had built a monument to the Great Fire to be used as an astronomical instrument. Basically, this whole thing is a zenith telescope with a hidden room beneath, and this is what happens when you give a bunch of experimental scientists a big budget and a high-profile building project. Not to be outdone by Hooke, Wren proposed that two huge lenses donated to the Royal Society by Constantine Huygens be installed in the cathedral to create a massive zenith telescope in 1704. It didn't happen, but it's fun to note the ideas that these scientists had. Okay, but let's talk about the most striking feature of the new St. Paul's, the dome. When you look up from the floor of the cathedral, you see a dome, but that's not the dome that you see from the outside. That dome you see is actually three domes in one. There's a decorated inner dome, a middle dome that's more cone-shaped than dome-shaped, and that famous photogenic outer dome that floats above the City of London skyline. Wren used a technique first presented by Robert Hooke at the Royal Society known as a catenary curve for the inner dome. The philosophy here is that a chain hanging from two fixed points creates a curve. When we invert that curve, we have a catenary arc. This shape is ideal for uniformly loaded arcs and uniformly loaded domes. This type of dome serves two purposes. One, it's the most efficient way to structure a dome using the least amount of materials but providing maximum strength. And two, it creates a slight illusion from the ground that the dome rises higher than it actually does. The middle dome used the same philosophy, but because the middle dome is responsible for holding up that very large, 88-foot-tall, 700-ton lantern, its shape resembles a chain with a heavy weight attached to its middle. Wren called this a cubico-parabolic conoid. Both these domes are built 18 inches thick, the length of two standard-sized bricks. The outer dome, as imposing as it is comparatively quite light. It's built of timber with only an outer shell made of iron. It rises about 94 feet above the rest of the building and has become a symbol of the city. The construction of St. Paul's, rising out of the ashes of the Great Fire, catapulted London into the modern world. This particular phoenix rose out of the ground on the power of its equations, the most advanced mathematics of its time, and the spirit of scientific curiosity. It's as much of a temple to the history of scientific inquiry, applied mathematics, and our insatiable curiosity as it is to any Christian deity. It's a temple constructed on the values of the scientific revolution. Alright, so this is a remake of another one of my older videos. I hope you liked it. Please leave me a comment in the description if you have any advice for future videos. Thank you for watching.